We make the world's best VISCA controllers in hardware. And when we say that, we have a few reasons why, and one of them is that we can give you so many different form factors. And I have made a video with the same camera we have right here, BRC-X1000, a VISCA over IP camera, and shown how it can be used with the RCP that are now supporting more and more cameras, not just Blackmagic cameras, but in this case, Sony robotic cameras, and it will be supporting any VISCA camera by time. So it's all a matter of installing the right device core, and you can see in the configuration for the RCP that we used in the different another video, we have installed support for the BRC-X1000 camera, and we showed how these encoders, and if I just click these encoders and select them, you see in the interface how they were mapped to settings on the BRC-X1000 camera. So when we turn one of these encoders, then it would select adjust matrix color, in this case the color level, and so forth. And this is how these products, the UniSketch system, works when you use them with our controllers, and that makes any of our controllers you find in the catalog able to talk to, for instance, that camera. So that's pretty cool. But obviously you want to have controllers that lend themselves to a particular case, like having a joystick, for instance, with a robotic camera. You want to have that, and also a layout that will help you. So today I brought this XC14 controller, one of the a module in the XC series that will be easy to set up with a robotic camera. So we'll be looking at that in this video. So what I thought would be fun to show you, apart from the configuration for this controller, is how it could be set up. So I have normally we have 8 buttons here with displays that at least able to map to camera selection. Today I just mapped them to camera 1, 2, 3, and 4, and then I have assigned these buttons and changed the color a little bit to a greenish color. So I have a focus infinity, focus one push, and AF sensitivity, that's autofocus sensitivity, and then focus mode between manual and auto. I've assigned these buttons to recall presets. Obviously I have a joystick for PTZ operation, and a top button on the top for well, you can assign it to anything. And I think today we set it up to home. So we can see, if we go to the web interface, for instance, then you see the top button right here. If I click it, then it pops up right here, and we can see that it's set to pan tilt. And then specifically, when I press this one to execute the home function, which brings back the head, the camera head, to a specific position, basically pointing straight ahead. If we look at the selector here and the menu, I have also assigned the two top tiles to just show status. So if I deselect the camera, you see the display goes out and it shows nothing. So when I select the first camera, then it shows the status for camera number one. And if I press and hold this one, I'll select camera two. So the interesting thing is I don't have camera two and camera three, unfortunately. So if I just select this one, you can see it's grayed out. But what normally happens if you had camera two and you select camera two like this, is that the display may for some values show you that, oh, this value is different on two cameras. So for instance, it's not possible to show multiple values for these cameras. But if it's the same value, like right now it thinks that we have the standard gamma set for both camera one and camera two, then it will show like that value. That's actually a pretty neat feature. You see it's repeated a few times here for iris shutter speed and gain. Obviously for a non-existing camera, it will not match the one that does exist. So this is why you see stuff like that. And then what happens now when I adjust the iris, and you can see this, is that those two cameras believe they have the same iris. I don't get any values back from the non-existing camera, so in the memory it just thinks that it has iris 4.4. Okay, so that's the multi-camera feature, and as I said in the other video, the cool thing is that you can actually select multiple cameras, and then, okay, let me just do it like this. And then let's say we wanted to adjust the or set the white balance mode. So for these cameras, I could now select the white balance mode for all of them, all four of them in one go. And that's a pretty neat feature. So if we look at what has otherwise been mapped to this menu, I can adjust the exposure mode, obviously, with this knob. So going through all the possible options, and you see the displays nicely reflect with a small no axis icon that I cannot adjust the iris and the shutter speed, because those two are not available in the gain mode. So I can adjust the gain. Yes, and you can see that and this is the reason why we actually keep the display, because I thought it was so cool you could still see the iris and the shutter speed values even though you cannot adjust them. So I wanted to keep them. So this is informative for you. And then if I change to another mode like iris mode, then obviously it's the shutter speed and the gain that we cannot change. And you'll see those values updated right there. So that's pretty awesome. If I go to this menu, you have AE speed, exposure compensation, on off, gain limit, and so forth. You have all seen this in the RCP, but in this case, because I have only four encoders right here and I am disregarding this section over here for now, then I have to map them slightly differently. And in this case, for the most important features, I just made them available like that. And then I'm also using shift keys over here at a later time. But let's see. So for white balance mode, you can see I have some white balance stuff. All right. And then for this is also related to the white balance, the R and B gain, for instance, depends on which white balance mode that I'm in. So if I'm in manual mode, I have access to R and B gain, but if I'm going to another mode, then they are grayed out and I have instead access to, for instance, the VB offset and also the VB speed in some cases. Right. So if I go to this mode, we can see we have the matrix mode can be set to different values. And I have some chroma suppression, which is actually a generic VISCA feature. And then in this menu, I have color gain, hue, and so forth. And that actually belongs to the matrix. So if I set that back to standard, you see those values pop up. And now I know that I have another four dimensions between the primary colors. And then using the shift key over here, I now have access to green, red, green, blue, blue, red, blue, and green. And I can go back. So I have assigned these two shift keys to kind of compensate for the fact that I don't have eight encoders. And then finally, we have the gamma mode right here. And again, I have used the shift keys to access the parameters that couldn't otherwise fit. I have the knee settings right here. So knee on off, manual auto mode, and so forth. You have seen that in the RCP video. And then I have crammed in details. So details are actually on the shift level here, and I put in two shift levels. So I can actually, if I first go to detail, I can push this button again and again, and then I can go through the different types of detail settings I can choose. All this stuff is 100% configurable in UniSketch, and you can go play with it on CoreSKAARHOJ.com. And if you do so, then you'll see the power of setting up these things. So just to give you some idea about how flexible and huge this is, if we look at just press anything here, like this encoder, for instance, and then it brings up the setting. So you see in this list, you see pan, tilt, zoom, focus, pan, tilt, limit, focus settings, iris shutter speed gain, AA speed, exposure compensation, and all this stuff. Much of the things you find in the top are generic VISCA features. But again, as I said, we have knowledge of the camera we are connected to. So if we have a device call for your particular VISCA camera, chances are that the complete command list, like 95% of everything the camera can do, is in this list and specifically supported with the value ranges that this camera has. So and the further down you come on that list, the more specific the features will be. Like this camera have some, you know, stuff like detailed parameters that I haven't seen on any other VISCA camera, and so forth. There's really a lot of depth to it, and it will be so much fun to explore this in a lot of other videos, showing you how much and how far we can go with the world's best VISCA controllers.